Hi.
Hi.
So, Matt, what's the story behind you starting the first priority music?
Well, back in I won't say the early days, the midterm of hip-hop, it was very difficult to get anything played on rotation on radio or even get on major labels. So what we all had to do to survive, we had to start independent labels and get our music into mix shows. So what we did a song, Milk produced a song called Top Billing, which we actually worked for about 6 months. We would bug all the DJs in New York and harass them and actually give them physical music. And they would go away, and then eventually we got a little foothold, we got legs. From that time to this time, Top Billing has now been sampled and reused 256 times. It's the most sampled record ever. Now, but at that particular time, that was the kickoff. And so we started to get noise with that, and we started getting radio play, and we started picking up. We couldn't pick up the nation because it was done. We picked up New York and Virginia, and then Chicago, and then Los Angeles because we had K-Day out there, and then Florida. So we were we were really sporadic around the country, just all over the place. And so what happened is we launched Light right behind that, and Light had a song called Cram. So I put Light and Milk Audio 2 out together on all the shows that we were doing. And eventually we were approached by Atlantic Records. A gentleman named Larry Yaskard, who I spoke to today, introduced us to Sylvia Rohn, and she signed us to an international record deal. And from there we started producing more stuff and putting more different Positive K, just tons of people. Michi Me were the first label in America that signed a Canadian group to a major label. So that was the first time any Canadian group was ever signed to a major US label. And so we did that, and then we branched out and we started doing more crossover music. We did a kid named Jason Downs. It was a European project, Jive, London. And he blew up number 7 on Top of the Pops, which is a British show. And then after that, we did Eamon. And Eamon was number 1 in 26 countries. He blew up overnight. And his song was called The Effort Song. And from there, we started dipping in film and things like that. And so we're still here. And we've got a lot more to say and a lot more to do. And that's the short, skinny version of it. None of the blood, sweat, and tears, okay?
Yes, and during that time, you wanted to interact with DJ Ian?
Yeah, we came here to Atlanta. I met a guy named Penguin, and Penguin introduced me to EU, and I actually been going to EU playing in clubs, which is amazing. It's just like next level. You go, did he record this? Did he record this mix? No, I didn't record it. No, please record it, you know. I want to take it home. And EU came into our lives, and him and Penguin did a song called ATL Ho, which we might hear in the background music later, we hope. And he's here to talk about his life and the things that he does and how he introduced me and Penguin introduced me to the EDM side of the music business.
Awesome. So, DJ EU, how long have you been DJing?
I've been doing it almost about 10 years. Started in 2007 here in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm originally from Puerto Rico. I've been around music. I've been playing instruments my whole life around like band. I started with clarinet, moved to like guitar, from guitar, bass guitar. Did the rock band through the high school years. Then after high school, I moved to the States from Puerto Rico to Atlanta to study engineering. And then throughout the high school process, I mean the college process, I kind of ventured out into a minor of marketing and found music again in a very rare form. I started doing it as friends, like the school parties, like, oh, let's go to the cabins. I came across a little setup. I was like, oh yeah, I think I know how to do this. Just have really good taste in music, apparently. And people were like, oh, you were really good. They hyped it up. Through the college years, I lost both of my parents. When I lost my mom, I kind of took the music and it was like my escape way, my getaway. So once my mom passed away, I took a semester off, did the music thing as fun, hanging out. And then through that process, I actually came across a radio station job for promotions. Just because of my minor in marketing and I knew a little bit of it, I went directly to becoming the assistant of the marketing director. And as time passed, I kind of started falling in love with like the industry, the business, the music side. And I took another semester off from school, got more involved, and I never looked back. And
goodbye school.
Goodbye engineering degree, yeah.
So you're from Puerto Rico.
Yes.
Does that have an influence on?
Definitely. When I started in the music, I started in the Latin industry. The radio station I worked for was a commercial urban Latin radio station here in Atlanta that no doesn't exist anymore. And as I was crossing over, like as I started DJing and picking up more, the Latin market in Atlanta was really small, so I wanted to DJ. I just wanted everybody to hear me play, listen to my music. So I ventured into what we call the open format top 40 crowd. And I think what made me stand out when I started into that market was bringing in the Latin elements into the clubs. I remember the first time I played at a big club, opera nightclub, which still stands, dropping a Pitbull track and the whole crowd chanting it. And to your normal club owner, that's like, wait, what? It's like, where's Chris Brown or where's DMX kind of thing? Dropping Daddy Yankee, Gasolina, and just cutting the music and the whole crowd going nuts because they know it, and the same reactions like, wait, hold up, what is going on? So that's how I feel like I made my stamp, bringing the Latin influence, bringing the Miami sounds into Atlanta, like giving some flavor is what I call to be different a little bit. So definitely being Puerto Rican gave it some flavor to my style of DJing. Yeah.
And I heard that you actually perform at Tomorrowland. So could you explain what Tomorrowland is for some people who don't know?
So Tomorrowland is the biggest festival, electronic or music curated festival, I would say either in the world, especially in Europe. It takes place in Belgium. It's been going on for years. They partnered up with an American company and started doing that festival, the same festival but called Tomorrow World here in Atlanta, Georgia. I had the opportunity of playing in it in 2015, and somehow we stayed in touch on, hey, here's my set, here's my video, thank you so much. Like, I thanked them like maybe 100 times just for giving me the opportunity, extremely grateful. And last time, email exchange came out to where, hey, we're not going to Atlanta again this year, but would you like to play in Belgium? I was like, wait, what? So it's like a joke. It's like, who asked you that? It's like, yes, where do I sign up? And it's like, so I was brought up with that opportunity to be like one of the first Atlanta DJs to actually do that festival. And not only that, it's like, a lot of these DJs that are playing these festivals have number one hits, number one records. They have a big production catalog. They've been associated in the EDM world. I was just booked more on the basis like they liked how I DJed. So it came down to what really the music, the DJing is all about. It's like style, performance, or just being a good DJ, not really having a number one record. And to me, that was like the bigger part of it. It's like I don't have a radio hit record. I don't have a closer like Chainsmokers or David Guetta, Sexy Chick with Akon. Like, I didn't have none of that. I just had, I guess, two turntables and a mixer, and it took me that far. It was amazing because once I, like, it kind of got back home, it came out to be like I was the first Puerto Rican DJ also to DJ that festival. So then just kind of put more pressure because I was like carrying the flag,
yeah,
and everything.
Really.
Yeah. It was awesome.
So you stayed complicated turntables, so you actually utilize turntables, because nowadays, you know, a lot of DJs actually have like a playlist on their computers, so they just press the button.
So I play on turntables, and still, so the way my setup is Serato, which is operating software that just pretty much communicates via an audio card with a mixer and the turntables. So it works the same if I was using real vinyl, but instead of switching songs via vinyl, all my library is on the computer. So it works like a hard drive kind of thing. I know how to use CDJs, but I prefer not to. My preference is turntables. I like to scratch a little bit. I like to quick mix. I feel more comfortable. It's coming to, so DJing is all muscle memory. So when I'm playing on CDJs, I'm like nervous, like looking extra, make sure. Where on a turntable, it's like I don't even have to look, and I know where my hand will go or what movement I need to do. So
probably from your experience with playing instruments.
Yeah, all of that. It just feels more natural. And there's a funny story about it. I started actually DJing on CDJs and putting CDs with like a bunch of tracks. And I got invited to DJ at MJQ's, which is one of the most renowned venues here in Atlanta. And there was two Atlanta OGs, Presto and Cristo Disco. And I was sharing stage with them. So when I showed up to the club, I was like, hey, yeah, where's the CDJs? And they literally started laughing. It's like, we don't play on that shit here. It's like, this is some real stuff. I already had played a few times on turntables, but I really wasn't very technical on it. I knew how to do my job. I'm very nervous, but it was so embarrassing. Like, two of the Atlanta legends, like pioneers, like been DJing all over the city, their name is known, just like laughed at me. The next day I went and took my CDJs, took it to a local shop. I was like, I don't care if I'm losing money, I just need two turntables, take this. I just need two turntables right now. And forced myself to learn how to play on turntables. And now it's like, if you don't put turntables, I won't play. It's like, no.
Awesome. Yeah. So what's your long-term goal from being a DJ? What do you want to do?
How do I say? It's like every DJ's goal should be just to play music in front of crowds, no matter where, how small, or what. When I started DJing in a midpoint in my career, I had the opportunity of moving to New York, and it was gonna be, I go to New York and become another New York DJ, or I stay in Atlanta and become the Atlanta DJ. I'm not sure if I'm there yet, but it's still a goal. You know, but as a DJ, any DJ should want to play in Vegas. Vegas is the mecca of the nightclubs, DJs. The festivals, with this festival boom, you want to get booked. I just want to keep playing music for people, to be honest. Definitely travel more, take my music to other people that haven't heard it. That's really the ultimate goal. And now crossing over into the production side, produce more original material that I can get to go to these places and play, oh yeah, that's my song, and you guys are dancing to it. Like, yeah, that's awesome. There's no better feeling than that, to be honest.
Yes. So where can we listen to you play?
Locally, I hold down residencies at Town & Groove, Gold Room, and Opera Nightclub are like the three main DJs. Every Wednesday, you can catch me at Town & Groove. They do a Latin night, but I play on the side room, so I don't specifically concentrate on Latin, like tropical sounds. Like, I don't play salsa or anything like that. They have another DJ doing that. You'll hear playing reggaeton, hip hop, house, trap, everything. Just a fun vibes. Then Fridays, I could fluctuate. I could be in town, I could be traveling. But if I'm in town, I usually play Ton of Groove. And then Saturdays, you'll find me at Gold Room every time I'm in town.
Awesome. And how do you know Bugsy Blue?
Through Nat. we kind of met Nat actually as taking over me as his DJ or artist. I don't know how to put it. He was mentioning, it's like, I have friends that could produce and help me on my production part, because I'm a musician, but I'm a DJ before I'm a producer. So besides me putting 20 hours in the studio, I still have to syndicate radio shows for Power 96, which is a local radio station. I still have to put practice routines, dig for music, so I don't have that much time to be in the studio producing. So a lot of the records that I've produced, I've co-produced. There's nothing better than being in a studio and two minds just kind of like share and nerd out and put something out. It's amazing. But Bugsy Blue being like an amazing producer, killer, it's actually a pleasure
so
to be working with.
So he's kind of like your mentor.
Pretty much, yes. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping to learn a lot from him.
So Bugsy, what do you do exactly? I heard you do a lot of different things. You have many masks.
Yeah, many hats. predominantly I'm a music producer and a composer. I've worked in sound most of my life. I've been playing instruments since I was very little. I've probably got about, I don't even know if I should say that, how many years I've been playing piano and keyboards and doing various different sound things, sound design. I've been producing for pretty much most of my life. Almost by accident.
And what's the story behind that?
Well, actually talking to somebody about this the other day. I went to stay with my brother in Albany. I'm from New York originally. And I went to stay with my brother in Albany, and he had this area in his apartment complex where there was this really nice piano, and I just always kind of like drooled after it, and it was kind of like almost like a Ray Charles thing. I just like touched it, and
felt the energy,
and then I just started playing, and a friend of my brother's had asked my brother, "Hey, is that your little brother playing upstairs?" And almost at the exact same time, he said that these two old people had come in and said, "Who's playing the piano upstairs? It sounds really nice." And I had never played before in my life, and I was just sort of feeling it. And I always sort of knew where not to hit, where the bad keys were, and so on and so forth. And then that sort of became my forte.
So did you ever get any formal training, or you just naturally know how to play instruments?
There was one person that I love, a guy out of New York by the name of Neil Alexander, who's in a band called Nail, and he was used to be a member of the band The Machine, which was like the largest Pink Floyd cover band in the world. And he had given me a lot of great tips in MIDI production and exercises that I could do to, keep my form. It was all about form, crossing your fingers, how you cross your fingers, what the do's and don'ts, and where you might run out of energy from being untrained. So I did have a little bit of training. Not much.
Okay. And who are some of the people that we may know or may not know that you work with or produce for?
Some people, I've worked with the legend, I call him a legend, my mentor, Daddy Rose, from Black Rose Cartel, who is otherwise known as Don Stone. I've worked with various members of Rough Riders. I actually used to rap.
What?
Yeah, I used to rap, and one of my tracks is called Phase Me, with featuring my brother Jonathan Rivera, Phase One, and Styles P, and my mentor, Daddy Rose.
Rolling with the homies, and all of them crazy. the grandmaster, sandblast your half Casper. Study the crowd, examine eyes like lens crafters, hitting runs like Colombians. Get it done, already chopping it up like a machete, son. I've already won, no half bacon, we crab cakin', sipping on Belvedere while Shorty's ass shaking, picking off rats like cats and black ravens. I don't need no punching, son. I flow with mad caves, crusting hype with ease like emphysema. Feel my frequency like radiation, cancer cleaner. SP stone.
I've been working with Nat, I think about almost seven years now.
Yeah, more than that.
And what's been longer? Specifically,
we've worked on several different ventures, from film and television projects,
animation
to music, and we actually formed a publishing company not too long ago called Noble Crowns, where we released an LP called The Cold Front with we had a bunch of different characters on that. We had Jadakiss, we had Styles, we had Black Butterfly, Rose, Phase One, or King Phase, and a bunch of independent artists that I still work with to this day.
But yeah, working with pretty prominent rappers.
Well, had a great mentors.
Yes. I grew up listening to Styles, so yeah. I definitely
Ghost.
So how was it working with them?
It was pretty amazing. He's a really cool guy. He actually recorded in my old house in Poughkeepsie, New York. He actually came down and recorded. And we all hung out for a while, and it was a pretty interesting time, I must say. You know, I actually was pretty impressed that he came down to my basement
actual
studio.
House. What about Jadakiss?
That was actually through my brother, who is really tight with them. They lived together in Yonkers, like right next to each other. They were at neighbors, and like, you know, he's a pretty cool guy. They're really cool guys, down to earth.
So Nat, what about this animation that you guys worked
with? Well, Stone wrote this story. It was the most amazing animation. It was a story about birds, and it's called Birdland. And in Birdland, it's kind of urban America. You have the pigeon family that lives in the flock jacks. You have the owls, which are the judges in the society. You have the eagles, which are the popo. and you have the seagulls who live on the beach front. The seagulls that live on the beachfront houses. And it was really good, a good script. You had the red robins, which were Bloods. You had the bluebirds, which were Crips. Okay. And it's just an amazing story. You had Jive Turkey, who was a turkey, he was a pimp. And what was the other? Rudy Rooster was his nemesis, which was a pimp. and it just plays into urban America through birds, through the eyes of birds. And these birds, you know, I could go all night, but the birds get to the point, they had never been out of their world. And one night they're driving, and they wind up going into another dimension of society in the world. And they were police. Now, because I'm not, you know, going against the police, but the police were pigs.
Oh,
physical
yeah.
Pigs.
I forgot about the
and they got arrested. So, you know, it just goes on and on. But
parody.
It's a parody on life. And it's just amazing. And the characters are amazing. It's just amazing that this could come out of one person's mind, out of Stone's mind. And he could bring it into illustrations and put it in. We're still working to put more stuff together on it. And it's a great project, Birdland.
Awesome.
Mm-hmm. Stone is a very, very
creative,
instrumental person in our lives that actually introduced us very many years ago. And I actually was working on his project almost 20 years ago, which was Daddy Rose the God.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is like a music god.
Exactly. So what's next for First Priority Music?
Well, I really want to break this film thing, and that's really the reason I came to Atlanta, because your 30% tax credit is an amazing it's an amazing incentive. And so, yeah, that's where I see it going. But right now, everything is multimedia now. It's no such thing as film and alone or music alone or, you know, anything. It's all multimedia. It all interlocks and crosses over to each other. So really, if you're really going to be honest with yourself, it's about multimedia. He's multimedia. I mean, you're multimedia. It's what we have today. Creating content is the most amazing thing I've seen in my lifetime. We have 1,000 cable shows and networks, and we don't have content to fill them. You have to look at Law and Order all day for 24 hours, and then you have to look at...
That's not necessarily a bad thing.
No, it is a bad thing when you have 1,000 stations and you can't... The bandwidth that we're dealing with right now, you could create infinity. There's no limit to how many stations. We can't fill up 1,000, so that means we're all going to have to work real hard, create a lot of content and a lot of entertainment, because again, it's multimedia in a global community. It's changed. It's totally different. So film, television. Mm-hmm.
So could you guys name three of your music gods in the industry? We can start with you, Matt.
It's going to be crazy. I'll tell you, you'll probably say, God, you come from hip hop. I was working on a project with Rick Rubin. And I went into a studio one night in L.A. and he was producing Johnny Cash. I walked up to Johnny Cash and he said, oh, Nat, I want you to meet Johnny Cash. I'm producing this new album. I shook that man's hand. And that was the first time I just felt like a little kid. I said, and if I had to name all the Johnny Cash's records, I couldn't. Maybe I can name four. But some reason, something about that man that moved me. I also met one time, I was with La and Light and all of us, Latifah, and we were at an event, and Naughty by Nature was there, and this lady who I grew up on, because not me, but my older sisters were into, she walks up to us all and says, I'm going to be presenting for you tonight, but I'm sure you don't know who I am. Everybody went, she said, my name is Nancy Wilson. And every rapper there said, we don't know who you are. Of course we know who you are, you know. And I don't know, I think that's my, those are two I really like felt like a fan, like really enjoyed, you know, relaxed. This is not about me or trying to sell something. It's just like enjoy. But don't get me wrong, I got rappers that I love to death, you know, that I do listen to every day. You know?
So what about you, Bugsy?
Actually, could you rephrase that question?
So who are your music gods in the industry?
Oh, probably some of my musical idols would be Robert Fitzgerald Diggs, a.k.a. the RZA. Which, you know, I was fortunately blessed to meet him several times, go to his house and parlay with him and, you know, really get to learn from a master. And also, you know, one of my comrades, Don Stone, one of the best that ever did it, one of the best pound-for-pound MCs, I think, ever, and, you know, a lot of people don't know about him, but was sort of like, you know, behind the scenes, the mentor of so many different MCs. And I would also say, this is a tough one, because I come from a really long line of hip hop. I've been in hip hop most of my life, but I have always had this passion for just creating any kind of music, anything. Literally, I'll play you a country song, but I can make you a banging EDM Moonbaton song. So, you know, music for me and being a producer, it's like really hard to choose.
Just three people. Yeah. Definitely understand.
Three people. I probably have three people for each category, but from my background, I would say, you know, and then also, you know, Hove is definitely one of the more, you know, influential characters that watching, you know, but then I can't say that because then there was Big L and then there's, you know, Punisher, and this is like all these wonderful people. It's really hard to choose. I'm just happy to be here and happy to be involved in music.
Thank you. So what about you, DJ EU?
That's hard. That's a really hard question. But people that I are in the moment that are inspiring to me in the moment, definitely Kanye West. I think his craziness is amazing.
Genius.
He's a genius, and that's why people are so against him. Same thing compared to Einstein. He was a genius, and people thought he was crazy. More on the EDM producer style, I believe Skrillex is one of the best producers in the world. The way he develops sounds, he's just very unique. He had a collab with The Doors. Like, who made an EDM record with The Doors? Like, nobody could say that except him. He made Justin Bieber what Justin Bieber is right now because of all his songs. Man,
Jack, you?
Yeah, it's really hard. So this is very, one person I've always looked up to and I never met and not a lot of people know. So my name is Eumir and it comes from a Brazilian artist by the name of Eumir Deodato. So like my parents, once like they knew I was a boy, pulled out a record, oh, this is what we're gonna name them. And it was awesome because it's like the coolest name ever. Nothing against Nat and Mike and that, but once I started getting into music, I started collecting. Once I got a hold of the original album that my parents owned, started collecting all his albums. And he's a jazz composer. He plays flute, saxophone. But then I kind of found out he is the executive producer for every Kool & the Gang record.
Oh. What?
Yes, wow. And he lives in New
really?
York.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, so it's just one of those things that I'm like, holy crap, and who doesn't love Kool & the Gang? Like, Kool & the Gang is Kool & the Gang.
My office in New York used to be right next door to
the. Well, hopefully one, he's still alive. Thank God he hasn't died. I'm really hoping to meet him. I won't ask him anything because his musical knowledge is probably retarded. Another person I think is genius, Justin Timberlake. So I'm talking more in my generation, people that I kind of listen to right now inspire me. I have many, it's like they said, I could go as deep as salsa, like Hector Lavoe, Willy Colon, all of that. I have so many, but it's people that are like, yeah, it's hard to choose.
Well, you know
like,
what, you get hooked up, because I have two more now. I know she said three, I thought about it. It's Dr. Dre and Quincy Jones.
Yeah,
and Quincy Jones.
Yeah, so those are... It's iconic, but like right now, where I look for inspiration, I would say, will be that thing. Like, I just got back from a trip from Cuba, and I was like mesmerized with Afro-Cuban beats. I was like, oh my God. It's like, I want to stay longer. I want to learn more about this. Like, yeah, stuff like that. So inspiration is always, but usually the go-tos right now are maybe those two, just because they're always kind of switching. They're bringing a new element. They're switching the sound. They're switching. You think, oh, this is the way music is going. It's like, nope, this is where we're going to go. And it's amazing because people will hate it at the beginning and then they're like, all right, let's go this way. And when you get to this way, they'll go this way. So.
Thank you.
Hey, I'm Matt Robinson,
DJ EU,
Tim from First Party Music. I want to shout out to my friends at MGM.
Music Gods Magazine.
Music Gods
Magazine.
Peace.
Thanks for having me.